Hello, I'm Richard.
And I'm Matt.
In this show, we'll each select five tunes on a particular theme. And this week, it's songs from film and TV. And as you'll see, one of us at least has interpreted this fairly loosely of songs from film and TV, but it should make for an interesting show anyway. Because Matt, I think you came up with this idea of a theme. What was your sort of motivation for this? Did you think you had a lot of tunes that you fancied playing?
I had three immediately that I knew I wanted to play. And it combines my two slightly nerdy loves of music and film. I've tried to choose songs which were written specifically for films or television. I think it's going to be a fun one. There's some really fun tunes in here and some really good stuff as well.
Well, I think we should crack on with number one, though. What have you got for your first?
I'm going to kick off with the genius that is Matt Berry. Now, we both love Matt Berry. He obviously is a comedic actor, very famous voiceover as well. He was in the IT Crowd. He sort of took over Chris Morris's place in the season two of the IT Crowd and played Chris Morris's son with massive kind of amounts of bombast, and everything he does is bombastic and silly. He was in the TV series, or still in the TV series of Taika Waititi's What We Do in the Shadows. He's just hilarious. But he also does music, and he's written and produced and sang on several albums, which are all this sort of slightly kind of Wicker Man-ish pastoral folk, which sort of walks a fine line between humour and spookiness, just is generally really cool. Anyway, this is the theme tune to his absolutely brilliant sitcom, Toast of London, which is about a voiceover, a sort of a voiceover artist, stroke actor who's at the end of his career and very frustrated because he can't get any work and he's got a massive ego. It's very, very funny. Having worked in TV and worked with voiceovers myself, it's one of those that I kind of watch between my hands, because some of the advertising characters that are in it are sort of very cringy and a little bit too close to comfort. But the theme tune is an interpretation of a single of his called Take My Hand, which we're going to play. And it's a really great little sort of romantic, slightly folky tune with a big piano riff all the way through it, and his very, very charming singing voice. He's a real Renaissance man, I think, and probably somebody you would very much want to go out for a drink with. It's a great tune.
I really love the theme tune to Toast of London. So I thought it was quite a sort of emotional sort of theme tune, really. It's a beautiful, it's slightly sort of, I don't know, sort of sad sounding almost, I think, as a tune. I mean, yeah. I haven't heard the original song, so this will be great to hear this. But I really love, really, really love the tune for it. And you can tell that he'd wrote it. Yeah, he'd written it himself, because I know that he'd done these sort of things. He's actually on Acid Jazz. The label he's on is actually Acid Jazz, believe it or not.
Yeah.
It's funny. I just thought it was quite a bit
incongruous. Yes, he is.
But he's amazing.
And he's done quite a lot of work with Saint Etienne as well.
Oh, right. Well, that's fantastic. So let's play. Cool. So what's this one called?
It's called Take My Hand.
Take My Hand, and this is Matt Berry.
Thank you. Witch Hazel.
Ah, charming old Matt Berry. He's fantastic. Absolutely. He's fantastic.
Yes, I can hear you, Clem Fandango.
Yes, I can hear you, Clem Fandango. He's the best. Clem Fandango, I think, is the sort of best, the best sort of picture of an advertising person, producer. It's just awesome.
I've met so many Clem Fandangos in my time. And the thing is, being a nerd, I tend to watch some of the Star Trek shows. And the actor who plays Clem Fandango shows up as a sort of a burly hero in one of the later Star Trek series.
Oh, no.
And I cannot watch it and take it seriously because I just hear him as Clem Fandango. It's it's very funny.
Right then. That's a great starting tune. So I think my starting tune, okay, is going to be something from a film, and it's actually the first thing you hear when you start one of my very favorite films, which is a film called Donnie Darko, starring Jake Gyllenhaal. And it really is one of my very, very favorite films of all time. It sort of goes back to the 80s of a sort of troubled, I guess, school kid, and it's lots of strange things happen. It's as if the sort of the end of the world is being predicted, and it's sort of quite a dark kind of brooding movie. But I just love this film. It's just a wonderful film, and it uses music very, very cleverly through the film. And actually, there are a couple of things I'm going to play. There's just one. Sorry, I'll edit that out. but it uses music really, really well, this film. And there were two or three points in it where they just use beautiful tunes. And the one I'm going to play is Head Over Heels by Tears for Fears. And it's kind of completely unforgettable, this tune, because the first bit of the film is the door of a school bus opens and a child's foot, child jumps out. And as soon as his foot hits the floor, the first note of this song starts. And it's just this awesome starting point for a film. I just think it's just so brilliantly put together, the music, and it's like you can just see where they go, right, we're starting now. It's just a brilliant, brilliant starting point. There's also some really lovely other music in the churches, in the film. One of them is called Under the Milky Way by a band which is I'd never heard of before, called The Church. And that's a really beautiful film. And of course, you've got a beautiful song, and you've also got The Killing Moon by Echo and the Bunnymen. And so, just some really amazing 80s tunes that might have been overlooked a bit. But yeah, this song, Head Over Heels, is actually my favorite Tears for Fears song. So I've managed to sneak it in to one of our weeks without having to justify it. So yeah, brilliant, brilliant song.
Yeah, it's great. It's a great movie, this. It's a bit like sort of John Hughes meets David Lynch. It's got that perfect kind of 80s teenage sort of soap opera-ness with a real heavy layer of surreal, not quite sci-fi. It's quite difficult to define, really. And it's one of those films that obviously it had a massive impact when it came out. And you can watch it over and over and pick up something. It is, again, like John Hughes, it just uses music, pop music from the time, to brilliant effect, to really land kind of feeling of the decade and of being a teenager in America at that time. And of course, it gave us that sort of cover version of Mad World, which has become a perennial kind of favorite, which is which is cool as well. But it's nice to hear the original Tears for Fears, because I love Tears for Fears. They're great, underrated, I think.
Okay, here we go. Tears for Fears and Head Over Heels. We'll be right back. Brill. Love that song. Love that song. What's number two?
Number two is I'm going to pick another theme tune from another comedy show. And it's another song that's been slightly reinterpreted. Oh, I know. There's a pattern forming. This is the end of the pattern. The Divine Comedy. Neil Hannon, who I absolutely love, you know, his kind of his songwriting and his lyrics, which are very, very funny. You know, he's just got quite a singular style to him. He's a very nice guy. He's a very amusing guy. Doesn't take himself seriously, obviously, but is really accomplished as a musician and a songwriter. And that comes across in his songs. You know, even though the lyrics are kind of amusing and tell kind of quite funny stories, they're wrapped up in music, which is really, you know, really beautifully written and really great little sort of 60s tinge pop songs. But he wrote, before he was well known over here, obviously, and I didn't know when I first watched the show, and it's a show that we're both a big fan of, but he wrote the theme tune for Father Ted. And the theme tune to Father Ted, which again is that slightly plaintive, kind of melancholy sort of instrumental piece, is actually a sort of a segment rewritten from a song called Songs of Love, which is off his second album, which had a bunch of other, you know, big hits in it, like Something for the Weekend and that kind of thing. It actually speaks about sort of young teenage love and the kind of introverts, creative introverts, sort of stuck in their bedrooms trying to write songs whilst all their mates are out chasing after girls and all the sort of confusion that goes with that. And it's a song I used to sing for my kids when I put them to bed, actually. So it's also an easy one to sing along to. It's just a very sweet little romantic song.
It's a great tune. It's a great tune. And it's actually reminding me, because I've got this LP. I've got the LP that this came from. And it's a fantastic LP. It's got things like Becoming More Like Alfie and things like that. Just great, great tunes. He just had this great ear for just a kind of a good pop song, but it's kind of quite whimsical. He's sort of I almost see him a little bit like Jarvis Cocker. There's a little bit of Jarvis Cocker, but sort of like much sort of posher southern Jarvis Cocker. It's just great stuff. It's just great stuff. And obviously Father Ted is complete genius. So you know, it's not even worth talking about Father Ted because it's just amazing. But this is a great choice for a tune. It's a great choice. And the actual song itself, you know, the theme tune, the actual theme tune is good, but the song is a really lovely song as well.
Yeah, he's very good at doing these sort of very evocative. Like I said, he does the humorous stuff, like Becoming More Like Alfie and Something for the Weekend. But he also does really sort of evocative and beautiful songs about just life in general. He did a fantastic song called A Charmed Life, which is about the joy of having your first child and all the sort of trials and tribulations that it takes to get there, but how having a kid sort of puts that all to one side. And it's a real tearjerker, but not in a soppy way. It's another good one to listen to, but you know, obviously this is not that. This is Songs of Love.
This is Songs of Love. This is The Divine Comedy.
Pubescent beasts roam through the streets and coffee shops. Their prey gather in herds with stiff knee-length skirts and white ankle socks. But while they search for a mate, my type hibernate in bedrooms above, composing their songs of love. Signs of desire they cannot disguise. While I try to find words as light as the birds in that circle above, to put in my song, my songs of love. Fate doesn't let the sun shine down from above and fill you with songs of love.
Take me.
Beautiful tune. I've actually not heard that for about 15 years, but it's
oh, really?
It's great. It's a great tune. Yeah. So, okay, I've got to find my second tune. So what am I going to play? I think I will play something else from the 80s that's been used in another film vaguely referencing the 80s. So this is, and this one came to me last of all the choices that I'd made, and I suddenly realised how much I, A, love the film, and B, love this song in it. And it's Notorious. It's the song Notorious by Duran Duran, which I love. And it's kind of that for me is almost that peak Duran Duran time, that LP. The LP Notorious is great. And the song is just one of their very, very best. And this is from Napoleon Dynamite, one of my favorite films. It is a really quirky, unusual film. I remember seeing this when I was in Washington, D.C. for a week or two. And I went to Georgetown, and I was sort of meandering around there. And, you know, I was just, I don't know, I think looking for a restaurant to go into. And I wandered past the cinema and I saw this poster and I thought, that looks bonkers. And I saw the times it was on. And I thought, oh, it's on now and I'm on holiday. I might go in and watch it. And it was just like this complete spur of the moment. Oh, I'll go and watch that. And I'm so glad I did, because it's just this really unusual film. I mean, you know, it's about this really unusual character that doesn't fit in, but it's all, everything's really exaggerated. All the characters in it are really either overplayed or underplayed. And it's got this really lovely sort of sweet heart at the sort of center of it. And it's very funny. And this basically, without doing too much spoilers about the film, this tune comes out towards the end of the film in a performance piece. And it's just a brilliant tune.
I love this movie. I've only seen it the once, but obviously, you know, it's a classic and it's hilarious and completely unique in its own way. I'd totally forgotten that this was the song that soundtracked, you know, probably the best scene in the whole film towards the end. Notorious. It's and what a tune, of course. You know, this is the point which kind of flipped the switch for me for Duran Duran. Beforehand, they were sort of, you know, they were a boy band in my eyes. And then this tune, obviously produced by Nile Rodgers, came out and it was just a bit spiky and very, very cool. And a really interesting song for them to choose for this part of the movie. Because it's, although I guess in some ways it's not, because when you watch the scene, it's the scene where he's dancing near the end. When you watch the scene, it comes out and you expect him to be terrible. And he's not. He's actually brilliant in a very strange Napoleon Dynamite way. So I guess using a song like this, which isn't a sort of cliche, cheesy 80s tune for him to dance to, it's actually quite a cool 80s tune. It was a really inspired choice for them to make. It's a great tune and, yeah, great movie.
Right, so here you go. This is Duran Duran and Notorious.
Notorious!
Nice. Okay, so tune number three. What have we got, Mr. Cole?
We're going to take a break so I can pull my chicken out of the oven.
That is not a euphemism, ladies and gentlemen.
No, and it's not a song. Hello.
So Matt's just got back. He's just got his chicken out of the oven, which will be nice. So have a go at that later, about 20 minutes. You know what?
It's a Sunday. Gotta
What?
have a chicken in the oven.
While you were out, I was just thinking that I'm gonna talk about this while we're actually doing the show because I can expose the doubt that I've got about this. I'm starting to think that that song that I was just talking about Napoleon Dynamite was actually in Donnie Darko, and I've mixed them up because wasn't that the film? Wasn't that the
Oh no.
it was Sparkle Motion that danced to Notorious, wasn't it, in Donnie
Was it?
Darko?
I
Wasn't
don't
it?
remember. Is that right?
But I might. So the thing is, it's good. This is a good conversation to have because it shows how you can mix these up. Because to me, there were bits of those films that had such similar feels to them. So Sparkle Motion was like a little girl dance group that did this thing in a show, and they did it to, I think it was Notorious that they did it, and I think Napoleon Dynamite danced to something completely different. And I'm
Completely different.
so I've all what we've talked about is complete nonsense. But anyway, they're good films, and they're good tunes. But the interesting thing about that was that
They are.
Notorious, they it actually works brilliantly in whichever of the two scenes it was in. I don't know, but it was going to be West End Girls by the Pet Shop Boys. They originally wanted to use West End Girls for that scene. They tried, and it was going to cost them too much money, so they had to find something else, and they found Notorious. So
Which
that
was
is actually
cheaper.
true. That is actually a fact. Unlike perhaps some of the other things I've been saying about Napoleon Dynamite or Donnie Darko, I mean, we can look at that later.
You've obviously completely pulled back the curtain on this entire show now, and now everybody knows we have no idea what we're talking
But
about at all.
complete fabrication. Anyway, and continuing the theme of utter fabrication, what's your third tune?
So my third tune I have decided is going to be the theme tune from my favorite film of all time, which is Blade Runner. So obviously, this is without a doubt the one of the greatest soundtracks ever by Vangelis. Obviously, the film was directed by Ridley Scott. At the time, sci-fi movies had kind of moved away, early 70s, like they were doing, and had moved into using more orchestral and classical kind of based kind of soundtracks since Star Wars kind of kicked it off with John Williams. And then Blade Runner took it back in that in a different direction and got Vangelis to create a completely synth-led soundtrack. But somehow, probably just because it's Vangelis and he's a genius, it's stood the test of time, this. It doesn't sound cheesy like a lot of synth-led kind of soundtracks did at the time. And the really interesting thing as well is that when you listen to this soundtrack, it's very difficult to sort of discern what soundtrack and what is sound effects within the film, because Vangelis actually created lots of the sound effects in the film and worked them into the music, which is very, very cool. So lots of kind of sort of there's a big explosion sound that opens up this piece of music that he actually put in. The sound of some of the they've got this big sort of dirigible that sort of commands the space over LA that's blasting out this advert the whole time, and the sound that makes is actually part of the soundtrack rather than a special effect in its own right. And it's one of the few soundtracks that I will just put on and listen to from beginning to end. I've got it on vinyl. I've listened to it over and over and over and over, and it's iconic. Nobody's ever tried to copy it. It's not one of these things that people thought, "Oh, this is the new trend now for sci-fi soundtracks or whatever. We're going to do the same thing." It just stands alone as it is, and it's completely brilliant.
Wow. I mean, that's really interesting. I don't have much to say about this. I've seen the film. I love the film. I knew the soundtrack was by Vangelis, and I know it. I kind of know it well. It's got that sort of kind of dark and brooding feel that the film has got. But yeah, no, it's interesting to know how they made it and what made it different to other soundtracks.
Yeah, and he really he kind of Blade Runner's got this weird sort of reused and recycled aesthetic to it, mostly because they couldn't afford to build brand new sets because the budget was relatively low. So Ridley Scott and his art directing team took the decision to take an existing back lot set in LA and then just sort of pimp it up by covering it in pipes and stuff. So you get this sort of this sense of a world that is falling apart, but it's just people just kind of sort of making do and nailing new technology to old buildings and stuff. And Vangelis kind of took that to heart as well. And there's moments in it where this sort of weird 20s and 30s kind of jazz music worked into the synth backdrop as well, which is, it's a really weird but very cool soundtrack in general, really.
Oh, sounds great. So we're going to play, is it the sort of opening sequence in the soundtrack?
It's the opening titles.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
But let's play it now. Here we go. This is Vangelis. Interesting stuff. It's going to make me want to go back and watch the film again, I think.
Like I said, I've seen the film. I've probably seen the film 100 times, and it's a film where you could stop it on any frame and print it out and put it on your wall, And the thing about the music is that when you listen to it, you see the film in your head straight away. They're so inextricably linked. It's a great piece of work.
Great stuff. Great stuff.
I quite like it. I don't know if you've noticed.
Okay, well, I'm going to have a think about my third one. And I think my third one is going to be from the film About a Boy. And it's the song called About a Boy. And it's by Badly Drawn Boy. And this film was a bit of a surprise to me, actually, because I wasn't really that keen to see it. It's from a Nick Hornby book. It's an adaptation of a Nick Hornby book. And I liked High Fidelity, the first adaptation of his book that came out. That was enjoyable. But this one is quite a different thing. But I thought I went to see it anyway. And I really loved this film. I loved this film. So it's got Hugh Grant in it as a sort of guy who is, you know, quite, you know, reasonably well off. But he's single and on his own, and he kind of likes being on his own, but he's sort of sees himself as an island. I think that's the quote in the film, like, you're an island. And he's almost sort of forced into helping out this sort of slightly unusual boy and his mum, and they don't have much money, and they're, you know, he's the kid's struggling to kind of make his way in the world a bit socially, but he's a good kid, and he's a sort of a character in his own right. And he's kind of reluctantly drawn into their lives and sort of helps him out and actually, you know, finds somebody nice himself in the end. So, oh yeah, it all ends happily ever after. But it's a really good film, and it's not too saccharine-y. It's kind of like there's a bit of love story in there, and there's a bit of, you know, life lesson stuff in there, but it's done with a lot of humour, and it's just a really enjoyable film. And the whole of the soundtrack was done by Badly Drawn Boy. And it's a really good soundtrack. He does all the sort of little sort of incidental sort of link bits of music. And there's some nice little sort of quirky little songs or sort of half tunes in there. But there's also two or three really great Badly Drawn Boy songs in there. And the main song, About a Boy is just a brilliant tune. It's a lovely, lovely tune. And it reflects the film really well, I think, because it's just got there's just a lovely sort of sentiment to it. It's just really enjoyable, and yeah, it just makes me happy.
It's a real example of a kind of a surprise. This surprise combination. This whole soundtrack, because you wouldn't expect. Somehow, I didn't expect Damon Goff to write a soundtrack. You know, he wrote lots of really, you know, really cool sort of early noughties pop songs, guitar-led pop songs, with a little bit of edge to them. But then this came out, and he'd done the whole thing, and it's really accomplished, and it works really well with the story and with the film, which is great. You know, this film was the first time where we saw Hugh Grant play a character that wasn't completely sort of, was a little bit grey, that wasn't completely sort of the bumbling, charming, nice guy. He's a bit of a dick, but he comes to sort of change and you know, become a nice guy towards the end. And that sort of that little sense of again jaunty melancholy that's in it really speaks about his kind of isolation quite a lot, I think, as a character in the film. And obviously, you know, he's a guy who's made a living off his debt, off the Christmas song that his dad wrote.
That's right. That's right.
Film. So, and he loves music, and he's trying to play the guitar, but he's kind of pissed that he doesn't have his dad's talent and this kind of stuff. So you kind of get the feeling that the music Damon Goff wrote for the film would be the music that Hugh Grant's character would have written if he had any talent, which is a nice little sort of little connection to it. And yeah, it's just a great song as well, isn't it?
It's a lovely tune. It's a lovely tune. So here we go. Badly Drawn Boy and About a Boy. Without the pain. Ooh, lovely. I haven't heard that for ages either, so it's nice to revisit that. I might have to revisit the LP. Okay, track number four, what have we got?
We are going to go for a tune by Beck from the film Scott Pilgrim versus the World, which was the first film that Edgar Wright directed that didn't feature Simon Pegg and Nick Frost. It was sort of his big, kind of slightly bigger budget announcement to Hollywood. And it bombed horribly, but has since become a massive kind of cult movie that everybody loves. And I love it. It's great. I didn't think too hard. And then I've seen it loads of times since. And actually, it's just a really, it's a really beautifully made love letter to comic books and video games that's done with a lot of passion and heart, and everybody's having such a brilliant time in it. But it's also very, very cool. The whole soundtrack was written by Nigel Godrich and has some kind of like, the film features a band called Sex Bob-omb, which Scott Pilgrim is a member of. And the music, actually, all their songs were written by Beck and Nigel Godrich. And it's got members of Radiohead actually playing the music and this kind of stuff. It's a cracking soundtrack. It's absolutely amazing. But the story of the film revolves around Scott Pilgrim, who's a bit of a sort of nerd, a loser. He falls in love with this girl who is his kind of dream girl called Ramona. And then he has to fight her, I think it's her seven exes for her love, basically. It's a very silly but very funny story. And at one point he says, oh, I've written you a song, to Ramona. And she says, okay, let's hear it. And he pulls out the guitar. And he sings this song, and it's basically just him repeating the words Ramona over and over again to this tune. And it's a really terrible song. And she says something along the lines of, oh, I'm sure it'll be very nice when it's finished. And then further on in the film, when it feels like the romance is dead, this version of the song, which has been completed, soundtracks this moment of kind of introspection of Scott Pilgrim. And it's by Beck, and it's just stunning. He's taken what is a joke and turned it into just a really stunning love song that has all that kind of, you know, when Beck isn't doing his kind of his funk thing, he's very good at doing ballads and they're really plaintive and really emotive. He's taken that and turned it into something which is it's quite heart-wrenching. And it's one of these songs that I've played to people and I said, you know, you should listen to this thing. And everybody goes, oh my God, that's amazing. Where's that come from? And it is. It's a beautiful sort of lost Beck tune on a soundtrack that for a film that should have been much bigger than it was.
And so the song is called Ramona. Is that right?
Yes, that's right.
Okay, and this is Beck.
Here we go. One, two, three.
Thank you.
There you go. A Lost Beck tune. Another Lost Beck tune. It was a great film. I have to go back to it because I remember seeing it and thinking I really enjoyed it. It felt just like one big video game to me. That's how I saw it. And I enjoyed it a lot.
Yeah. And that's kind of how it was.
Great tune. Okay.
Kind of how it was constructed. And it's got all those references in the graphic.
Yeah. Brilliant. Okay. So
we got Lagging.
My fourth tune is from a film called Everyone Wants Some, which is a Richard Linklater film from about 4 or 5 years ago. And it's kind of, it's meant to be the sort of a vague follow-up to Dazed and Confused, one of his sort of breakthrough sort of hit films. And but I much preferred Everyone Wants Some. It's a brilliant, but it's about sort of high school jocks in the 80s, or it's a group of high school baseball team, and it's all these characters have sort of been thrown together in one house for the start of the new term. They're all, you know, fairly talented baseball players in their own ways, but some of them don't know each other. And it's about the story of a couple of new guys that go into the house, and you know, and what the term is like, basically. And it's just a brilliant film. I mean, I love Richard Linklater films, and this one is particularly good in that not much really happens in it, and you're kind of, they just have loads of fun, basically. It's just these kids meeting each other, playing a bit of baseball, you know, chatting to girls, a few little like stories develop, just playing stupid jokes on each other, drinking, going clubbing, and just having an amazing time. And you're throughout the film, you're expecting, you know, some twist to happen where, you know, something goes wrong. You know, there's often like a moral sort of element in films where they go, well, they're having fun now, but woof, oh no, they'll pay for this, you know, this sort of action. And they don't pay for it at all. They just have an amazing time. And it's just, it's this brilliant homage to that being young and to being happy. And it's just a completely joyous film, and I love it. And it's got loads of 80s and sort of 70s music in it, including a great thing for sort of Grandmaster Melly Mel. They do it's as you would with your friends in the car. They put on what is it? It's not Rapper's Delight. I think it's Adventures on the Wheels of Steel, something like that, in the car. And they turn it up, and they all basically do the rap throughout on a car journey together, and it's just. It's brilliant. It's kind of a film about friends, and they use the music really well in it. And this tune is called Take Your Time, Do It Right, and it's by the SOS Band. And it appears when they go to a nightclub. And if you've not heard the SOS Band before, then you need to start investigating their stuff, because they are completely hidden, underestimated band from the 80s. They were fantastic and did brilliant tunes, mainly because they were produced for about 3 or 4 LPs by Jimmy Jam and Terry Lewes. And they wrote and produced this stuff. And they are just brilliant singles that they produced. They produced, you know, Just Be Good to Me. They produced, this, Take Your Time, Do It Right, is just an awesome song. And they've got 3 or 4 brilliant LPs. And and this is just a awesome tune.
Yeah, you played me this film. I'd never heard of it, actually. I didn't even know there was a sequel to Dazed and Confused, which I loved the original film. And it's a really nice little follow-up to that. It's a little more innocent, but it is, it's a cute movie, and it is very kind of, it's very transportative back to that time. And I love the SOS Band. I kind of, for some reason, Just Be Good to Me came back into my library relatively recently, and it's been one of these songs that I always go back to the point where I tracked down the album on vinyl and had to pay a flipping fortune for it, because it's really hard to get hold of. Again, one of these bands that are sort of, I don't know, just underrated and almost sort of dismissed as a kind of 80s pop band, and they weren't at all. Their songs are amazing, and like you say, you know, really amazingly produced, and tunes you just have to dance to no matter what, really. So yes, I don't remember this one, so I'm very much looking forward to hearing it.
Here we go. It's the SOS Band, and Take Your Time, Do It Right. Ah, tune. The tunes. So
big lush 80s pop.
We've got one more each. One more each.
We have.
What have you got?
One more each. Well, here's what I've got. So in the 90s, you had two people who were sort of the kings of pop music soundtracks. You had Tarantino, obviously, from Reservoir Dogs to Pulp Fiction, packing his films full of quirky, weird, lost songs and making them iconic again. And at the end of the scale, you had Danny Boyle, who, you know, created probably the definitive movie pop soundtrack of the 90s with Trainspotting. But prior to that, he directed a film called Shallow Grave, which was the first film he worked with, I believe, with Ewan McGregor, and then Christopher Eccleston was in it as well. It's a great little sort of psychological kind of movie about three quite annoying people who share a flat in Scotland and are looking for another flatmate. Keith, God, I'm going to forget his name.
Alan.
Keith Allen. Keith Allen turns up and he's in it for about 5 minutes playing a dodgy geezer who takes the room and dies. And then they find a big suitcase full of money and have to decide what to do with his body. And obviously everything goes downhill from there. And it's a really tense, really quite nasty film. It didn't quite have the sort of the glut of new and cool pop music in it that Trainspotting did. But it did have a fantastic opening title sequence and tune from Left Field, who weren't famous at the time. It was before their big album came out, and obviously before they'd done the music of the Guinness movie, a Guinness advert, sorry. But it's just this really sinister, driving, aggressive synth workout that soundtracks this, the opening title sequence, which starts in the middle of a forest, which is where they end up burying Keith Allen's body, and sort of almost from first person goes at speed through this forest, through the streets of Edinburgh, up to the door of the flat, up the stairs of the flat to the door, and the door opens and Ewan McGregor's there and he's inviting somebody in, inviting the audience in basically, but it turns out the audience is somebody who's come for an audition for the flat. And this music is just, it just churns and gets bigger and bigger and bigger. And it's such a fantastic opening to a film. As soon as you see that sequence and you hear this music on top, you're in. And you want to know what's going to happen next. It's very, very cool.
I loved Shallow Grave. I thought it was a brilliant film. I remember it from seeing it at the time. But I don't remember the Left Field tune at the start. So, yeah, I can't wait to hear this. But, I just remember that being a great film, just quite suspenseful and just fun. It was very much of its time as well. It has a sort yes. of book of, yeah, that sort of period.
The haircuts in particular.
So this is Left Field, and do we know what the name of the tune is?
It's just called Shallow Grave, I think.
Just called Shallow Grave. Okay, so this is Shallow Grave by Left Field.
I'm not ashamed. I've known love, I've known rejection. I'm not afraid to declare my feelings. Take trust, for instance, or friendship. These are the important things in life. These are the things that matter, that help you on your way. If you can't trust your friends, well, what then? What then? This could have been any city, but all the same. We'll be right back.
Nice, yes. Nice to hear an old left field track. We haven't had that. We haven't had any of their stuff on, have we, actually?
No, we haven't. We haven't. No.
They're a big one. Okay, well, so the last tune we're going to play, well, there's a little handful of tunes here. So I said that one of us had interpreted this theme a little bit broadly. the first thing I thought about when Matt said, you know, songs from TV programs and films was theme tunes. And when I was a kid, I sort of looked back to my childhood and to TV and my childhood as, you know, with very, very fond memories. Because I think so many of the children's TV programs that I watched when I was a kid had brilliant theme tunes. And just all for various reasons. So what I'm going to do is my final tune is a sort of compilation of a few of these tunes. So among these tunes are Rhubarb and Custard, which is just completely manic, frantic. It's a manic sort of program, and it was a manic sort of manic piece of music. It was brilliant because it was narrated by Richard Briers, who was just a hero of everything. But that was just an amazing program. We've also got Jamie and the Magic Torch. Do you remember that?
Oh, yes.
That was an amazing, so it had a brilliant theme tune. And it had this amazing thing of this boy who, you know, went to sleep and woke up in the middle of the night and used to have this torch. He used to get out of bed, point it at the floor, and where the light made this circle on the floor, this magic hole opened up and he was able to go down a helter-skelter with his dog and into this whole different world. It was a bit like sort of Pepperland almost, from sort of Sergeant Pepper. But it was just that fantasy of being able to shine a torch and a hole open up. I remember doing that in my bedroom once or twice as a kid.
Being disappointed.
Oh, come on. Anyway, brilliant, brilliant theme tune. So that's another one. The third one I've got is Chorlton and the Wheelies. Mm. Now, that was an amazing theme tune. And that was, I don't know, how do you describe this? This is kind of a sort of animated kids' TV program with a large, not very bright dragon and a wicked witch. And the dragon was, I think, Brummy. He used to go, "Hello, little lady." That was what he used to do. And brilliant theme tune. And then the final one is, well, it's one of my all-time favourites, is Bod, which is a sort of animated, very simple animated cartoon about a boy called Bod and just various characters that he knows, like, who's it? Aunt Flo, Farmer Barley, and Farmer Barley Mo, and it was narrated and all the music done by the genius that is Derek Griffiths, who was just a kind of one of these sort of staple characters who was dominant in children's TV around, you know, the sort of 70s and 80s, along with Brian Cant, another great hero. And but the thing about Derek Griffiths is he wrote so many brilliant tunes. He was just really good at doing sort of very, very light tunes. So he wrote a wonderful Heads and Tails as well. That was an incredible program. So again, a bit like Animal Magic with Johnny Morris, where he used to sort of talk over the video of animals, you know, just going about their normal animal business. But I actually preferred Derek Griffiths. I mean, I thought Heads and Tails was just a wonderful, very, very funny thing and just charming music. And so we'll put Heads and Tails on there as well as the last one, because that's just ace. So I've wibbled on for ages. I could go on for hours about kids' TV. But yeah, please feel free to add anything you want to that.
It's the thing is, as soon as you mention all these tunes, I can hear them on my head and you just want to sing them. You just want to sing all of them. Because they were probably written for that, so your kids could sing along. But they're just really... You know, all the music in Bod is brilliant. All the theme tunes for the different characters are hilarious and kind of funky and jazzy and weird. There was always, obviously, as there was with so many of the 80s and 70s kids TV shows, conspiracy theories. Apparently Aunt Flo was a prostitute PC Plod was her regular customer and all these kind of things.
How dare you?
It was.
What an outrage.
Subcontext. And, you know, Rhubarb and Custard was just painted anarchy. I remember watching Rhubarb and Custard as a very little child with my mum and us both just in peals of laughter. And the soundtrack, na 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 na. It was just hilarious. All these tunes was just hilarious. And you do still remember them and sing them now. And yes, Derek Griffiths is a god. And I met him once, as you know, because I got him I got your his autograph for you.
My most treasured possession.
You've got to say when we were talking before recording this,
Matt was saying that he was a bit sweary, Derek.
Derek Griffiths is a very sweary man. He's a very funny, very sweary man. I was sort of working with him as a voiceover artist when I was working at Capital Radio, and he was just in the booth. And he's one of these guys that would turn up early and just talk and talk and talk, and was very funny, and just dropped many F-bombs, which was always hilarious, considering that he was such a massive part of my childhood. So, yeah, very nice man.
So, we'll leave you then with Derek effing Griffiths and a range of other artists with a collection of a few kids' TV themes. Thanks for listening, and we'll be back next week with another theme, which we'll decide in the next few days. See you then.
Bye.
Sleep well, Jamie.
Shoulder who's the dragon, he will keep you free from harm. It's fun at any time of year. So put your wheel in second gear and then hold tight. All right, we'll show you all the sights of Wheelie World.
Heads and tails, eyes and whiskers, horns and nose. Heads and tails, here we go. heads and tails.